Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Robot Who Looked Like Me, Stories, by Robert Sheckley, narrated by Johnny Heller. The Robot Who Looked Like Me. Snaith's Robotorama is an unprepossessing shop on Boulevard KB-22, near the Uhuru Cutoff in Greater New Newark. It is sandwiched between an oxygenator factory and a protein store. The storefront display is what you would expect. Three full-size humanoid robots with frozen smiles, dressed occupationally. Model PB2, the French chef. Model LR3, their British nanny. Model JX5, the Italian gardener. All of them ready to serve you and bring a touch of old-world graciousness into your home. I entered and went through the dusty showroom into the workshop, which looked like an uneasy combination of slaughterhouse and giant's workshop. Heads, arms, legs, torsos were stacked on shelves or propped in corners. The parts looked uncannily human except for the dangling wires. Snaith came out of the storeroom to greet me. He was a little gray worm of a man with a lantern jaw and large red dangling hands. He was some kind of a foreigner. They're always the ones who make the best bootleg robots. He said, "It's ready, Mr. Watson." My name is not Watson. Snaith's name is not Snaith. All names have been changed here to protect the guilty. Snaith led me to a corner of the workshop and stopped in front of a robot whose head was draped in a sheet. He whisked off the sheet. It was not enough to say that the robot looked like me. Physically, this robot was me, exactly and unmistakably. Feature for feature, right down to the textures of skin and hair. I studied that face, seeing as if for the first time the hint of brutality in the firmly cut features, the glitter of impatience in the deep-set eyes. Yes, that was me. I didn't bother with the voice and behavior tests at this time. I paid Snaith and told him to deliver it to my apartment. So far, everything was going according to plan. I live in Manhattan's upper fifth vertical. It is an expensive position, but I don't mind paying extra for Skyview. My home is also my office. I am an interplanetary broker specializing in certain classes of rare mineral speculations. Like any other man who wishes to maintain his position in this high-speed, competitive world, I keep a tight schedule. Work consumes most of my life, but everything else is allotted its proper time and place. For example, I give 3 hours a week to sexuality, using the Doris Jens executive sex plan and paying well for it. I give 2 hours a week to friendship and 2 more to leisure. I plug into the sleep inducer for my nightly quota of 6.8 hours and also use that time to absorb the relevant literature in my field via hypnopedics and so on. Everything I do is scheduled. I worked out a comprehensive scheme years ago with the assistance of the Total Life's Plan people, punched it into my personal computer, and have kept to it ever since. The plan is capable of modification, of course. Special provisions have been made for illness, war, and natural disasters. The plan also supplies 2 separate sub-programs for incorporation into the main plan. Sub-program 1 posits a wife and revises my schedule to allow 4 hours a week interaction time with her. Sub-program 2 assumes a wife and 1 child and calls for an additional 2 hours a week. Through careful reprogramming, these sub-programs will entail a loss of no more than 2.3% and 2.9% of my productivity, respectively. I decided to get married at age 32.5 and to obtain my wife from the Guarantee Trust Matrimonial Agency, an organization with impeccable credentials. But then something quite unexpected occurred. I was using one of my leisure hours to attend the wedding of one of my friends. His fiancée's maid of honor was named Elaine. She was a slender, vivacious girl with sun-streaked blonde hair and a delicious little figure. I found her charming, went home, and thought no more about her. Or I thought I would think no more about her. But in the following days and nights, her image remained obsessively before my eyes. My appetite fell off, and I began sleeping badly. My computer checked out the relevant data and told me that I might conceivably be having a nervous breakdown. But the strongest inference was that I was in love. I was not entirely displeased. Being in love with one's future wife can be a positive factor in establishing a good relationship. I had Elaine checked out by Discretion, Inc., and found her to be eminently suitable. I hired Mr. Happiness, the well-known go-between, to propose for me and make the usual arrangements. Mr. Happiness, a tiny, white-haired gentleman with a twinkling smile, came back with bad news. "The young lady seems to be a traditionalist," he said. "She expects to be courted."
"What does that entail, specifically?" I asked.
"It means that you must video phone her and set up an appointment, take her out to dinner, then to a place of public entertainment, and so forth." "My schedule doesn't allow time for that sort of thing," I said. "Still, if it's absolutely necessary, I suppose I could wedge it in next Thursday between 9 and 12 p.m. "That would make an excellent beginning," Mr. Happiness said.
"Beginning? How many evenings am I supposed to spend like that?"
Mr. Happiness figured that a proper courtship would require a minimum of 3 evenings a week and would continue for 2 months.
"Ridiculous," I said.
"The young lady seems to have a great deal of idle time on her hands."
"Not at all," Mr. Happiness assured me. "Elaine has a busy, completely scheduled life, just like any educated person in this day and age. Her time is completely taken up by her job, family, charities, artistic pursuits, politics, education, and so forth."
"Then why does she insist upon this time-consuming courtship?"
"It seems to be a matter of principle. That is to say, she wants it."
"Is she given to other irrationalities?"
Mr. Happiness sighed. "Well, she is a woman, you know."
I thought about it during my next leisure hour. There seemed to be no more than 2 alternatives. I could give up Elaine, or I could do as she desired, losing an estimated 17% of my income during the courtship period and spending my evenings in a manner I considered silly, boring, and unproductive. Both alternatives were unacceptable. I was at an impasse. I swore. I hit the desk with my fist, upsetting an antique ashtray. Gordon, one of my robot secretaries, heard the commotion and hurried into the room.
"Is there anything the matter, sir?"
he asked. Gordon is one of the Spenny's Deluxe Limited Personalized Series androids, number 12 out of a production run of 25. He's tall and thin and walks with a slight stoop and looks a little like Leslie Howard. You would not know he was artificial except for the government-required stamps on his forehead and hands. Looking at him, the solution to my problem came to me in a single flash of inspiration. "Gordon," I said slowly, "would you happen to know who handcrafts the best one-shot, individualized robots?"
"Snaith of Greater New Newark," he replied without hesitation.
I had a talk with Snaith and found him normally larcenous. He agreed to build a robot without government markings, identical to me, and capable of duplicating my behavior patterns. I paid heavily for this, but I was content. I had plenty of money, but practically no time to spend. That was how it all began. The robot, sent via Pneumo Express, was at my apartment when I arrived. I animated him and set to work at once. My computer transmitted the relevant data direct to the robot's memory tapes. Then I punched in a courtship plan and ran the necessary tests. The results were even better than I had expected. Elated, I called Elaine and made a date with her for that evening. During the rest of the day, I worked on the spring market offers, which had begun to pile up. At 8 p.m., I dispatched Charles II, as I had come to call the robot. Then I took a brief nap and went back to work. Charles II returned promptly at midnight as programmed. I did not have to question him. The events of the evening were recorded on the miniature concealed movie camera, which Snaith had built into his left eye. I watched and listened to the beginning of my courtship with mixed emotions. It went beyond impersonation. The robot was me, right down to the way I clear my throat before I speak and rub my forefinger against my thumb when I am thinking. I noticed for the first time that my laugh was unpleasantly close to a giggle. I decided to phase that and certain other annoying mannerisms out of me and Charles too. Still, taken together, I thought that the experiment had come off extremely well. I was pleased. My work and my courtship were both proceeding with high efficiency. I had achieved an ancient dream. I was a single ego served by 2 bodies. Who could ask for more? What marvelous evenings we all had. My experiences were vicarious, of course, but genuinely moving all the same. I can still remember my first quarrel with Elaine, how beautiful and stubborn she was, and how deliciously we made up afterward. That making up raised certain problems, as a matter of fact. I had programmed Charles II to proceed to a certain discrete point of physical intimacy and no further. But now I learn that one person cannot plan out every move of a courtship involving 2 autonomous beings, especially if one of those beings is a woman. For the sake of verisimilitude, I had to permit the robot more intimacies than I had previously thought advisable. After the first shock, I did not find this unpalatable. Quite the contrary. I might as well admit that I became deeply interested in the films of myself and Elaine.
I suppose some stuffy psychiatrist would call this a case of voyeurism, or worse. But that would be to ignore the deeper philosophical implications. After all, what man has not dreamed of being able to view himself in action? It is a common fantasy to imagine one's own hidden cameras recording one's every move. Given the chance, who could resist the extraordinary privilege of being simultaneously actor and audience? My dramas with Elaine developed in a direction that surprised me. A quality of desperation began to show itself. A love madness of which I would never have believed myself capable. Our evenings became imbued with a quality of delicious sadness, a sense of imminent loss. Sometimes we didn't speak at all, just held hands and looked at each other. And once Elaine wept for no discernible reason, and I stroked her hair, and she said to me, "What can we do?" And I looked at her and did not reply. I am perfectly aware that these things happened to the robot, of course. But the robot was an aspect or attribute of me, my shadow, twin, double, animus, doppelganger. He was a projection of my personality into a particular situation. Therefore, whatever happened to him became my experience. Metaphysically, there can be no doubt of this. It was all very interesting, but at last I had to bring the courtship to an end. It was time for Elaine and me to plan our marriage and to coordinate our schedules. Accordingly, exactly 2 months after its inception, I told the robot to propose a wedding date and to terminate the courtship as of that night. "You've done extremely well," I told him. "When this is over, you will receive a new personality, plastic surgery, and a respected place in my organization." "Thank you, sir," he said. His face was unreadable, as is my own. I heard no hint of anything in his voice except perfect obedience. He left carrying my latest gift to Elaine. Midnight came, and Charles, too, didn't return. An hour later, I felt disturbed. By 3 a.m., I was in a state of agitation, experiencing erotic and masochistic fantasies. Seeing him with her in every conceivable combination of mechanophysical lewdness. The minutes dragged by. Charles, too, still did not return, and my fantasies became sadistic. I imagined the slow and terrible ways in which I would take my revenge on both of them. The robot, for his presumption, and Elaine, for her stupidity in being deceived by a mechanical substitute for a real man. The long night crept slowly by. At last, I fell into a fitful sleep. I woke early. Charles, too, still had not returned. I canceled my appointments for the entire morning and rushed over to Elaine's apartment. "Charles," she said, "what an unexpected pleasure." I entered her apartment with an air of nonchalance. I was determined to remain calm until I had learned exactly what had happened last night. Beyond that, I didn't know what I might do. "Unexpected?" I said. "Didn't I mention last night that I might come by for breakfast?"
"You may have," Elaine said.
"To tell the truth, I was much too emotional to remember everything you said."
"But you do remember what happened."
She blushed prettily. "Of course, Charles. I still have marks on my arm."
"Do you indeed?"
"And my mouth is bruised. Why do you grind your teeth that way?"
"I haven't had my coffee yet," I told her.
She led me into the breakfast nook and poured coffee. I drained mine in two gulps and asked, "Do I really seem to you like the man I was last night?"
"Of course," she said.
"I have come to know your moods, Charles. What's wrong? Did something upset you last night?"
"Yes," I cried wildly. "I was just remembering how you danced naked on the terrace."
I stared at her, waiting for her to deny it.
"It was only for a moment," Elaine said, "and I wasn't really naked, you know. I had on my body stocking. Anyhow, you asked me to do it."
"Yes," I said. "Yes, yes." I was confused. I decided to continue probing. "But then when you drank champagne from my desert boot..."
"I only took a sip," she said.
"Was I too daring?"
"You were splendid," I said, feeling chilled all over. "I suppose it's unfair of me to remind you of these things now."
"Nonsense. I like to talk about it."
"What about that absurd moment when we exchanged clothing?"
"That was wicked of us," she said, laughing.
I stood up. "Elaine," I said, "just exactly what in hell were you doing last night?"
"What a question," she said. "I was with you."
"No, Elaine."
"But Charles, those things you just spoke about..."
"I made them up."
"Then who were you with last night?"
"I was home alone." Elaine thought about that for a few moments. Then she said,
"I'm afraid I have a confession to make."
I folded my arms and waited.
"I, too, was home alone last night."
I raised one eyebrow.
"And the other nights?"
She took a deep breath.
"Charles, I can no longer deceive you. I really had wanted an old-fashioned courtship. But when the time came, I couldn't seem to fit it into my schedule. You see,
It was finals time in my Aztec pottery class, and I had just been elected chairwoman of the Aleutian Assistance League, and my new boutique needed special attention, so what did you do?
Well, I simply couldn't say to you, look, let's drop the courtship and just get married. After all, I hardly knew you.
What did you do?
She sighed. I knew several girls who had gotten themselves into this kind of a spot. They went to this really clever robot maker named Snaith.
Why are you laughing?
I said. I, too, have a confession to make. I have used Mr. Snaith, too.
Charles, you actually sent a robot here to court me? How could you? Suppose I'd really been me.
I don't think either of us is in a position to express much indignation. Did your robot come home last night?
No. I thought that Elaine, too, and you...
I shook my head. I've never met Elaine, too, and you have never met Charles, too. What happened, apparently, is that our robots met, courted, and now have run away together.
But robots can't do that.
Ours did. I suppose they managed to reprogram each other.
Or maybe they just fell in love, Elaine said wistfully.
I said, I will find out what happened, but now, Elaine, let us think of ourselves. I propose that at our earliest possible convenience we get married.
Yes, Charles, she murmured.
We kissed, and then, gently, lovingly, we began to coordinate our schedules. I was able to trace the runaway robots to Kennedy Spaceport. They had taken the shuttle to Space Platform 5 and changed there for the Centauri Express. I didn't bother trying to investigate any further. They could be on any one of a dozen worlds. Elaine and I were deeply affected by the experience. We realized that we had become over-specialized, too intent upon productivity, too neglectful of the simple ancient pleasures. We acted upon this insight, taking an additional hour out of every day, 7 hours a week, in which simply to be with each other. Our friends consider us romantic fools, but we don't care. We know that Charles II and Elaine II, our alter egos, would approve. There is only this to add. One night, Elaine woke up in a state of hysteria. She had had a nightmare. In it, she had become aware that Charles II and Elaine II were the real people who had escaped the inhumanity of Earth to some simpler and more rewarding world. And we were the robots they had left in their places, programmed to believe that we were human. I told Elaine how ridiculous that was. It took me a long time to convince her, but at last I did. We are happy now, and we lead good, productive, loving lives. Now I must stop writing this and get back to work.
Slaves of Time. Gleister Mainline Sequence Time Track 1.
Charlie Gleister had invented a time machine, but he hadn't invented it right because it didn't work. His machine was about the size of a white plastic shoebox. Its surfaces were covered with dials and switches and levers and buttons. It made funny noises when Charlie turned it on, and its glow bulbs flashed purple and green, and it made his skin tingle. But nothing else. Charlie's machine was a very good tingler and flasher and noisemaker, but it was not a good time machine. It didn't become that until later, after Charlie had gained enough insight from the future so that he could adjust the machine to work properly in the present. There is a paradox involved in that, of course. Time travel is full of paradoxes. The universe runs on paradox power. So, there was Charlie on a beautiful September afternoon in his basement laboratory on Apple Street in the unincorporated township of Harvest Falls, Indiana, tinkering with his machine and talking out loud to himself, saying things like, oscillation, deployment factor, beat phase regeneration, infinite recycling amplitudes, second force reflection coefficient. This is the veritable language in which genius communicates with itself, and Charlie was definitely a genius, even though Myra's father thought he was a mite loco. Myra's father was the leading banker in Harvest Falls and a keen amateur psychometrician. Myra was Charlie's fiancée. Just now, she was out for a drive with Carter Littlejohn, once the finest tailback in Hoosier history, now a locomotive salesman and the future father of Myra's illegitimate daughter, Hilda. Gleister's parents lived in a condominium in Jupiter, Florida, played bingo every Friday night, and wrote to Charlie on the first of every month. These people play no part in the story. Gleister also had an Uncle Max who lived in Key West and was known locally as the Pinochle King of the Conches. He also plays no part in the story. Nobody plays any real part in the story except Charlie Gleister, who plays entirely too large a part, or too many parts. But that's what happens when you begin to jump time tracks, as Charlie Gleister is about to do. In the meantime, however, he was seated at his workbench, putting tiny components together and taking them apart again, and getting grease on his white shirt and cursing mildly and waiting for a gestalt to form or an insight to occur or something to happen. And then something did happen. A voice behind him said, excuse me. Gleister mainline sequence time track 1+2. The hairs on the back of Gleister's neck stood erect. He knew that he had bolted the lab door. His hand closed idiotically on the handle of a micrometer weighing perhaps 30 grams. He turned slowly. "Didn't mean to startle you," the man behind him said, "but there was no other way. I've come about a very important matter." Charlie relaxed his grip on the deadly micrometer. The man did not seem to be a dope and flame mugger. He was a tall, lanky man of about Charlie's own age, with a long, homely, good-natured face. He was holding a white plastic box covered with dials and switches and levers and buttons. There was something familiar about him. "Do I know you from somewhere?" Charlie asked. The stranger grinned and didn't answer. Charlie looked at him, taking in the white shirt stained with grease, the khaki slacks, the Tom McCann ripple sole shoes. "Oh, my God," Charlie said. "You look just like me." "I am you," the stranger said. "Or you are me, or more accurately, we're both Charlie Gleister, occupying different time tracks." "How can that be?" Gleister asked. "That's a silly question for you to ask," the other Gleister said, "seeing as how you have just invented the world's first time machine and are therefore the world's leading expert on the nature of time." "But I haven't invented it yet. Not so that it works." "Sure you have." "Well, you will very soon, which comes to the same thing." "Are you certain about that? I seem to be doing something wrong. Could you give me a hint?" "Of course," the other Gleister said. "Just remember that reality is positional and that nothing happens for the first time." "Thanks," Gleister said doubtfully. "Let me see if I've got this straight. I'm going to get my time machine working soon, go into the future, then come back and meet myself just before I invent the time machine." The other Gleister nodded. "That's sort of weird, isn't it?" Charlie asked. "Not at all," the other Gleister said. "You come back to now in order to urge yourself not to invent the time machine." "Not to invent it?" "That's right." "Just a minute," Gleister said. "Let's start all over. I invent a time machine and go into the future and then come back to now and tell myself not to invent a time machine. Is that what I'm going to do?" "That's it. But you don't have to keep on referring to us both as I. We're both Charlie Gleister, of course. But we are also separate individuals, since we occupy different time tracks and are, were, will undergo different experiences at different moments in subjective time. So even though we're the same people, that makes us different, since reality is positional." "I'll take your word for it," Gleister said. "Or my word for it, I think. I'm getting a little hysterical. Why shouldn't I invent the time machine I invented?" "Because it will be used for evil purposes." "Could you be more specific?" "Just take my word for it. I have to get out of here now. You and I talking together in the past constitutes a regressive temporal paradox, which can be maintained for only a few minutes and then is self-canceling. Progressive temporal paradoxes are another matter, of course, but you'll learn all of this yourself. Just believe me. Do yourself a favor. Don't invent that time machine." The other Gleister began to shimmer faintly. Charlie called out, "Hey, wait, there's a couple of things." "Sorry, I'm a smack out of duration," the other Gleister said. The shimmering intensified, and his figure grew transparent. "How do you like this for an exit?" the other Gleister asked, grinning self-consciously. "See you around." The other Gleister disappeared. Gleister mainline sequence, time track 1. After the other Gleister had gone, Charlie needed only a moment to decide not to not invent the time machine. He didn't like taking orders, not even from someone who called himself, which was arguable anyhow, since reality is positional. If it was so important not to invent a time machine, let the other Gleister not invent it. Charlie went to work immediately, and knowing that the thing was possible, needed only 2 hours to get his time machine working properly. Nothing happens for the first time, especially if what you're trying to do is to invent something absolutely novel and unprecedented. Of course, if nothing happens for the first time, that leaves the apparent problem of how anything happens at all. But the difficulty is entirely semantic. In the eternal recurrence of subatomic configurations, of which our world is a simulacrum, there is no question of beginnings or endings. There are only middles, continuations, repetitions. Originality is a concept possible only to a limited viewpoint. So there was Charlie with his fully operational time machine neatly encased in a white plastic box, and now he is going on a journey into the future. But how? Consider, time and space are potentially equivalent quantities. They can be transformed into each other via the deus ex machina of a time machine. Take a simple analogy. You have 5 oranges and 3 apples. You want to add them together. To do so, you must first convert apples into oranges or oranges into apples or both into something else. The formula for converting apples into oranges is taste divided by flavor plus the square root of color multiplied by seeds squared. You handle space-time transpositions in the same way, but using the appropriate formula. A time machine is no more than a real-time space-into-time converter operating on recycling interface energy residues. The practical application is a little more complicated than that, of course, and only Charlie Gleister was ever able to make it work. That may seem to be a violation of the law of eternal recurrence, but exceptionality is also subject to repetition, as will be seen. Gleister set the machine's controls for the limit of its forward ability, a matter of some millions of years of human time, or several hours from the viewpoint of a star, or a Google of chilicosms from the outlook of a paramecium. He pushed the button. Something happened. At Gleister's level of awareness, he seemed to be traveling on a straight line extending between past and future, a line capable of countless branchings as chance or circumstance arose. But seen from a higher level of magnitude, a time track is a fixed orbit around some unimaginable center, and what feels like a deviation is mere perturbation in an inevitable circle. Only the macrocosmic outlook permits the fiction of straight lines and novelty. The microcosm is the realm of circularity and repetition. The interface between these distant realities is coincidence. Rate of coincidence is a function of rate of speed. Travel fast enough and far enough and long enough, and you get to see the cosmic scenery, the haunted landscapes of eternal recurrences. Gleister experienced a brief moment of vertigo, Storter effect, and then there he was, the world's first time traveler, standing in the unimaginably far distant future. Tremulously, he looked around him. The first thing he noticed were the policemen. Gleister mainline sequence, time track 1, variation A. Determined to keep my eyes and ears open and my mouth shut, one of the first things I notice is the accommodation effect which regularizes my experience. Inseparability of subject and object, constancy of sense ratios. It is also familiar. I suppose that an electron traveling from one atom to another also expects to enter a realm of unimaginable novelty. But perhaps the scenery in every part of the universe is roughly similar, since one sees in accordance with who one is rather than with what is there. Linguistic accommodation as well. Are they speaking my language or am I speaking theirs? I can never know. The transaction cannot watch itself being transacted. I am in the town of Mingusville 32S. There are at least 4 different sets of uniformed police on the streets. Municipal, political, secret, and special police. I am posing as a Nepalese sociology student writing a thesis entitled The Ecstasy of Conformity. This theme is acceptable to officialdom of any time period and explains away my shishi accent and lack of present-day knowledge. Mingusville 32S is a ramshackle place, containing some interesting technological retrogressions, steam-operated vehicles burning dried cow dung, for example, as well as many horse-drawn vehicles, and mules, oxen, and even a few camels. Is this due to depletion of fossil fuels? And whatever happened to atomic power? Mingusville has a rudimentary communication system, but only officials have individual telephones. Electricity is scarce and expensive, and equipment maintenance is haphazard. I estimate that 2/3 of the homes use kerosene lighting. No structure is higher than 3 stories. Cinder block construction sometimes faced with brick or tile. Center of town is dominated by large open-air market facing gigantic police barracks. My impression is that the people around here lead uneventful, slothful, unchallenging lives. This is reflected in their willingness to drop whatever they're doing and talk for hours with a stranger such as myself. I learned that various diseases are endemic here, equivalents of trachoma, encephalitis, tick fever, etc. Cholera and bubonic plague devastated this region 6 years ago. There are many beggars in the streets, although this is forbidden by the Emperor. Blacks and whites are present in roughly equal quantities. I am unable to detect any appreciable difference in social status on a racial basis, Everybody here seems to be equally deprived. Government is the only interesting game in town. One man rules the world, the Emperor Mingus. He maintains a standard police state. Mingus is your typical paranoid fascist, has everybody watching everybody else. There are cameras and recorders everywhere. Miles of film and tape, legions of people monitoring all of this, other people monitoring the monitors, and so on, until you get to the Emperor, the ultimate monitor. I wouldn't have believed you could control a world this way, but Mingus is giving it a pretty good try. He is aided in all this by a secret weapon. It seems that Mingus possesses a time machine. When something goes wrong, he can, subject to certain natural restrictions, go back in time and correct it. It's a hell of a good way to take out underground leaders. Don't bother combing a city or countryside for them. Just go back to before they went underground.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.